about introduce our candidates and take over.
All right.
Thanks.
Thank you, Rob. I'm still Todd Pronto. I won't go through my whole introduction. I did want to mention that I didn't mention on the last one that we are filming both of these for NEKTV. You'll be able to catch them on Channel 15. However, if you don't have Comcast cable, they will be posted on YouTube as well. You can just look for NEKTV. There's a dash, so NEK-TV. And I think that's about it. It's going to be the same as last time. Each candidate has 3 minutes allowed for an opening statement and 3 minutes for a closing statement. Answers to the questions will go 2 minutes. We are going to ask to keep it as brief as possible to allow for more questions to be asked, but if you can be specific, don't just give yes or no answers, I guess. Such as, if you think regulation should be eliminated, say what regulation, that kind of thing. I guess that is about it for the rules. We will stagger the answers, so everybody will take a turn starting and finishing the order. We will go right down the line for opening statements. We have with us this evening, Marsha Horn, to my left, so your right, and then Senator Bobby Starr and Senator John Rogers, and we'll go right in that order for opening statements. And you guys are going to have to share a microphone because...
Is this okay? Can you hear me all right?
Is
it loud enough, folks?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Just one microphone. NEKTV is a nonprofit, so that's all we can afford. And in fact, it's all my stuff. It's not even NEKTV's. All right, Marsha.
I'm Marsha Horn. Some folks might remember me from the last election. I ran for a Senate seat against Senator Starr and Senator Rogers. They've been with us for a while. I'm a local marketing consultant, web designer, and also the owner of Experience, the Northeast Kingdom, a project I built 6 years ago. We've been doing a lot of good up here in various towns. I'm also a retailer for GoDaddy Products and Services. I moved to the Northeast Kingdom of Vermont 14 years ago and raised my children. We both attended North Country Union High School. My daughter went to Rensselaer Polytech in Cornell. She's an engineer with the United States military. My son went to Clarkson, and he's an engineer with Global Foundries. They're both doing very, very well. I have a BA in political science from Wheaton College. I have a further studies in financial analysis, economics, and corporate finance. As years back, I was a candidate for Chartered Financial Analyst Level 1. In 2009, I also attended the International Academy of Design and Technology for Web Design. And I'm a former stockbroker, a former innkeeper, and currently enjoy my work very much. At the present time here in Vermont, there are several challenges that now face our legislators and Vermonters. A number of these challenges have been self-induced by the current administration. We have a declining workforce, and we now have a population decline. We have a level and a style of budgetary spending that is overextended itself. For fiscal 2017, they're expecting a $66 to $68 million shortfall. Much attention has been given to health care costs. People in Vermont, the problem with health care costs has to do with the state funding single payer health care in Vermont Health Connect, not actual health care costs. And meanwhile, 97% of Vermonters are insured, up from 93% prior to the Affordable Care Act. And we have one of the highest levels of insured residents in the country. Single-payer health care, $300 million was spent, and it's not feasible, it's not enforced, and it can't be. $200 million a year for Vermont Health Connect. For Vermont's 625,000 residents, while New Hampshire uses a grid system, and in 2015 it cost New Hampshire $16 for New Hampshire's $1.33 million residents. Twice as many people and one-tenth the cost. The current trend in excessive state spending decline and tax receipt base as workforce is leaving makes it clear to us that we must change the way the state manages its funds and its policy. The answer to this problem for many Democrats is to raise taxes. Is my time up?
Yeah, I forgot to mention Scott is our timekeeper.
He's so raising cards.
I'm sorry. That was my mistake. So the first card is 30 seconds and the second is
time. We couldn't afford a red card.
We couldn't afford a red card.
I apologize, Marcia. I forgot to mention
that. That's
okay. We can let you finish your.
Can I just finish this one?
The last sentence, yep.
Certainly. The answer to the problem for many Democrats is to ask the sales tax and initiate a carbon tax, to add to the sales tax and initiate a carbon tax. So the expectation that Vermonters will be better convinced to buy an electric car and pellet heating system, and that people will stay here and pay more taxes or be better convinced to make Vermont their home. That's not the case. When you make it more expensive, it's less enticing. I'll finish with that. Let these two gentlemen continue.
And Bobby, you get to vote. Sorry about the little catch with the microphone cord there.
Yes.
We can't afford wireless microphones either.
Thank you, Todd. And I want to thank the sponsors for hosting this evening. And certainly you folks for attending. Most of you probably know me. I'm Bobby Starr from North Troy. Grew up on a family farm on the West Road. Was quite active in high school with sports, but very active in the Future Farmers of America organization, and went on to become state president of that organization, which is made up of young people from all over the state. Went on to VTC, Vermont Technical College, graduated with an associate's degree in agriculture, thinking that I was going to be a farmer. But as it turned out, the farm that I was going to farm on, the barn burnt my senior year at Randolph. Was right on the corner to go to Jay Peak, and Jay Peak was a very was really just taking off at that point in time, and that land was very valuable, and my family was bound and determined they were going to build a barn there for me. And I said, hey, you guys have never had a nickel in your pocket. You've got an opportunity here, and Bobby will look out for himself. So anyways, I worked for the Department of Agriculture, Weights and Measures, for a year, year and a half, and they wanted to ship me off to working out of my home in North Troy, my folks' home. They wanted me to go to work for them in Chittenden County, being that inspector for that area. And I thought hard and long, and it just wasn't right for me. I knew I wanted to raise a family in Troy or in the Northeast Kingdom and be part of that. So I came home and I went to work for my uncle and worked for him until 84. Bought the transportation company from him at that point in time, and ran that business until this past, in 2012. And employed 35 people at the High Point and 25 tractors and 50 trailers. But anyhow, it's been a pleasure serving you people for many, many years, either as your state rep and now as your state senator. And hope to ask for your support in this next election. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Senator John Rogers from Glover. Thank you all for coming out, and thank you for the sponsors and NEK-TV as well. I grew up in Glover on a dairy farm that my family has farmed. I was the fifth generation to grow up on a farm. And it's funny, in the Senate and in the legislature as a whole, there are fewer and fewer people every year that are connected to the land. I think I'm the only senator that actively hunts and fishes, and I have all my life. I think I'm the only one that still works in the woods. I have a small construction business that I have run since I was in my early 20s, doing stonework and excavation and just about anything else that people want done, mostly on the small lots around the lakes, mostly around Glover. I've been very lucky that I have not had to travel far for lots of years. I think the farthest I've traveled this year is out to Brownington to do some work at the old stone house. I live in Glover with my wife Brenda, who's a nurse at NVRH, works in the day surgery. I have one boy serving in the Navy. He's currently deployed on a cruiser. And I have one son who is a graduate of VTC, graduated with a four-year degree in electromechanical engineering and is working at Weidman down in St. Jay. One of the things that I have done as a legislator, both when I was in the House and as a senator, is work very hard for the area's businesses, especially agriculture and forestry, and also have been very strong in voicing support for traditional uses of the land, hunting, fishing, trapping, and of course our Second Amendment right as well. So Bobby and I have worked very well together. When I came into the House, he was actually appointed to my as my mentor. So I learned a lot from him, and he and I sit together on the floor of the Senate, and especially in the last couple of years, we've accomplished a lot working together. One example is the ag equipment dealers were having trouble. Certain manufacturers want them to carry only one line of equipment, and we know that that doesn't work around here. People want choices, and so I drafted a bill for them, and Bobby did a ton of work on it in his committee. We ended up getting that passed so that we can keep our equipment dealers healthy, and we also, based on an amendment I offered last year, got the exemption for farmers, the ag exemption, changed from 98% use down to 75% use. The tax department was giving some farmers trouble when they used their tractor to plow the snow in their yard. It wasn't considered agriculture, and so they were trying to get their ag exemptions away from them. So that's just a couple examples, but thank you very much.
All right, and we'll start in with the questions. We're going to stagger them, so we'll put the microphone in the middle with Bobby. And then it'll go John and then Marcia, and then it'll go John. But I got this under control. We'll be fine.
Can you tell him 2 minutes this time?
2 minutes, yes. And I did forget to mention earlier, Scott is the scorekeeper over there, so he'll hold it. The first yellow card means 30 seconds, and the second yellow card means your 2 minutes are up. And the questions are the same for all three candidates. The first question being, what do you think are the three most pressing issues in your district?
I thought long and hard about this this question, because I saw Newport, the people in Barton were asked that, and I believe it's the opiate problem. We have is the largest problem. Act 46 is a major problem, and then the economy is the third issue that I would say is our three largest problems. Does that answer your question?
Sure. And John?
I would say affordability would be the biggest issue. Pay in the state of Vermont, and especially in the Northeast Kingdom, is relatively low, and the expenses are relatively high. I think probably the second would be the business climate. regulation, and I think if we help businesses instead of inhibit businesses, that raises people's pay, provides more employment, and hopefully is one of the answers to the affordability problem. And then I think the overall drug policy, and especially the opiate problem, is a huge issue, both for the health of the state of Vermont, but also for the finances of the state of Vermont.
And Marcia.
Oh, thank you. Heroin trafficking and addiction. Also, economic growth and sustainability. Let's include with that the big hole that's in downtown on Main Street. Left over in a big question mark in terms of what's going to happen there. Include with that the uncertainty with that project. I'd also include health and human services funding for childcare. In living in Newport and in various parts of the kingdom, including Island Pond, one trend and one repeating issue, one overriding issue, though of course we have all kinds of things that are important to us, but one overriding issue is funding for daycare or bringing our child, or not my child, their child, children, to a program that will give them a head start. In Island Pond, people literally moved out of town. I went down there, one whole side of the street, of Main Street, just vacant, absolutely vacant. Not a store was open. They had all closed, and restaurants, and one had foreclosed and the others were just vacant. And a lot of people left. And it was when Head Start closed. Up here in talking to moms and people, you know, they're raising kids and daycare is an issue. Funding for daycare, also after school programs and extended learning opportunities would be a tremendous help there. Those are the three issues that I see happening. Thank you.
The next question will start with John. And then it'll go to Marcia and then Bobby. That question is, in view of both the North Country and the Orleans Central Supervisory Union's opposition to Act 46, the school district consolidation law, what do you think should be done? Do you view that law as an effective way to improve education and save money?
Well, I did vote against it. I did not think it was a good law in the beginning. When I checked in on what the education committee was doing and saw that this was the direction they were headed, I offered them an alternative. This bill forces our schools, who are already doing a good job educating the kids and keeping the cost down, to go through unnecessary steps. It's typical of the legislature and their one-size-fits-all. What it doesn't do is deal with high-spending towns, and my bill would have. What it basically would have done is set the appropriate level to spend on a pupil at the statewide average, which is around $14,000 per pupil. If you wanted to spend more than that, you could, but you would have to come up with it in your own community on your own tax rate. And if you spent less than that, you would be able to reduce your education property tax rate. Carrot and stick. What's happening right now is we have schools that are spending $20,000 per pupil, and the rest of us are helping them subsidize it on our property taxes. That's one of the drivers of our high property taxes, and it needs to be corrected. So we're too far down the road to repeal Act 46 because some districts are going through the process to meet the new law, but we in this area don't need it, and there are changes that need to be made so that our schools can continue to do the good work that they've been doing.
Act 46 addresses the issue of declining enrollment and lowers over in general, and of course throughout Vermont, the overall cost for people. Up here, schools are doing a very good job. However, as a legislator, we need to be concerned with all of Vermont and not just our district. I liked Act 46. I liked Act 46 for a few reasons. Clearly, the act addressed and mended or set forth the changes to accompany and a declining school population. And I know in Brighton they have a falling population, and whether or not Brighton would have to be included with another elementary school, I believe they will be if Act and Act 46 will be implemented. There are a few passages that make it very rigid in terms of should a school's population decline, all of a sudden they'll have to merge again. You know, you'll have your schools merge, and if there's some fluctuation, according to Act 46, they'll have to begin the process all over again. I hope that can be somehow amended. We sure do need to look at this situation without rose-colored glasses. We need to understand that funding school education can be better school served, and the children can be better served, the community, etc., if costs are low, and education would be superior with that. Thank you.
Yes, to start with, years back I spent 21 years on the local school board in Troy, served on the supervisory union board in Derby, Newport Derby, served on the Senate Committee of Education and chaired that for 2 years. During my term as chair of that committee, we set up a voluntary program called REDS, where school districts had incentives to join together and combine, but it was up to the local towns and to decide that. And Act 46 was thrown together over on the House side, basically, with a new chair, many new members that were just elected to the legislature, and it really was put together very poorly and not properly taken out to the communities to have input and hear input from school board members, school administrators, and our Senate committee had a new chair this last term, and she was also very naive about the way schools function. John presented a proposal to them. I was supporting that. We talk about a lot of issues down there, and I was supporting that because if you look at statewide, we spend $1.6 billion on 80-odd thousand children. Pretty simple arithmetic that's $20,000 a student. What we spend up here in the North Country Supervisory Union is about 15.5. We spend 14.5 at North Country and about 15.5 down the Lake Region. So we're well below, that's per student, so we're well below the cost. And I just didn't think that ramrodding Act 46 through and onto our communities was fair. And I really think that our two school districts do a super good job.
I already answered that.
You did.
Marcia starts the next question. Where did I put it? There it is. All right. Do you support your respective party's nominee for president?
I'm a Republican, so that'd be Donald Trump. And I support him in terms of his political stance on the issues. He's tough on immigration. He's tough on the war on terrorism. He's tough on the economy, trimming the economy and facilitating growth in terms of, by way of just simply letting the economy grow, something the Fed hasn't been doing. I'm very much in favor of. He'd like to build a wall down in Mexico, just end the problem there. He's addressing a number of issues. He has captivated so many, many Americans. He is outspoken, and is very often, he's pointed to as being the culprit. Meanwhile, other people make their remarks, and other people bring out their own level of slander. Maybe he brings it out in them, but when it started with people being very critical of Donald Trump, now appears to be on both sides, to some degree, in some way. Slanderous remarks and delving into private lives, etc. And it's sort of sad because I would have preferred to have heard more from him concerning the issues. Thank you.
My preferred candidate for president lost in the primary. I supported Bernie. We've worked together for many, many years, I think, quite a guy down here in Washington. So back to your question, though. If I'm going to vote, I'd either have to write his name in or vote for Hillary, because there's no way this side of heaven that I'd vote for Donald Trump. If you think about some of the things he said, it's very disheartening. He's going to chase all the foreign workers out of here. Look on the label of anything you wear and see where it was made. When you go to the grocery store, see where the vegetables and all those things are. They're coming from the Midwest and the West, and they're all picked by foreign workers. Our apples here in the state of Vermont are being picked by immigrants they bring in. Even the farmers are hiring Mexicans to come and milk their cows because they can't find reliable help here. So I guess I'm going to be voting for Hillary, because I certainly don't want Donald to get elected, and I think she's the best of two evils, you might say.
I'm going to start with a joke, because I think the presidential election is a joke. If Donald Trump gets elected, Canada's going to build a wall to keep us all out. We are. That said, the simple answer to the question is no, because as Bobby said, he's voting for the lesser of two evils, but the lesser of two evils is still evil, and I'm not voting for either of them. I am going to write someone in. Well, I might vote for myself, but I will not be voting for Hillary or Donald.
All right, the next question we'll start with Bobby. And then we'll go to John and to Marcia. And so far I've got the order correct, because I'm keeping notes here. The question is, are you satisfied with the process used in sitting renewable energy projects?
Absolutely not. It's shameful the way our renewable siting is done.
Thank you. The word is sighting. I've read it wrong three times now. I said sitting, but it is sighting.
You don't want to sit?
No. Well, they told me every time, and I still read it wrong.
The way it is designed and the way it's set up is maybe something that would have worked 15 or 20 or 30 years ago, before we had all this renewable energy, when they were putting light poles through or building Vermont Yankee, there were large facilities like the Burlington Wood Plant. I could understand that, but now with this renewable energy, the rules should be changed so the Public Service Board has to honor a community's input and wishes. And when it comes to wind turbines, it shouldn't just be the community that they're sitting in. It should be the all the communities that are affected by it should have some input into that process. And if you know, we tried to do a decent siting bill this last year, but it really was not good. I would hope that this next session we'll be able to do something more positive to right that wrong. But it depends on who gets appointed to the chair of the Natural Resources Committee. You know, I'm hoping if we get reelected, I'm hoping that I'm in a position where I can help John get to be chair or vice chair, at least at the very minimum of the Natural Resources Committee. And I think we can get another 2 years, I think we can get that straightened out.
The simple answer is no, I'm not satisfied at all, one single bit. There should be local control. I introduced a bill last year that would ban industrial wind in the state of Vermont because I don't think it is appropriate for the state of Vermont. People who actually have experience with industrial wind and know about the wind resource here will tell you that the math doesn't work out. That is before the environmental impacts. Every acre of forest sequesters the carbon of 63 cars. The vision of the industrial energy developers who are backing Sue Minter, and she has bought into it, they want to develop over 200 miles of industrial wind. That is thousands of acres of forest clear cut, displacing habitat, no longer available for forestry, no longer sequestering carbon, no longer slowing the rain, filtering the water, and storing the water on the mountains. Industrial wind does no benefit for Vermonters. It is a scam by the super wealthy, the one percenters that Bernie rails against all the time, are getting filthy rich on this. Each industrial turbine is making the owner about $1 million a year. And it's all about money, and the reason that they're able to do it is because they know how much money can be made, and they literally have an army of well-paid lobbyists in the state house working people over every single day. The money that they contribute to campaigns is excessive, and they are basically buying the legislation to allow them to continue to rape Vermont's environment and fill their pockets.
How many acres is that, John? How many acres did you say with industrial?
The plan of over 200 miles is thousands of acres.
Thousands of acres, 200.
Clear cut, deforested.
I'm against that as well. No, come on, that's not the answer. Phil Scott at his economic plan, and I endorse Phil Scott. I feel his economic plan is the answer. He is against, you know, adding another wind farm. We don't need another wind farm. We're just a little bit shy, folks, of self-sustained power generation. What we can do is look at all our state colleges and universities, state schools, high schools, elementary schools, offices, town offices, in terms of going solar and utilizing pellet fuel systems gosh, if any of them are using electric, we can switch that over too. We can start by going green. And the state of Vermont did pass a bill to go green. And then when winter comes, they're buying fuel oil and, you know, getting the boiler fired up and sending out carbon dioxide into the air. The state can do better than that and position itself for lower costs down the road, saving taxpayers quite a bit of money in the future. Thank you.
Next, next question, we'll start down with John. I bet you didn't know you were going to get a shoulder workout, Bobby.
Yeah.
Moving the microphone back and forth. You might want to use your left hand next time. Just distribute. What could be done to improve Vermont's business climate and attract jobs?
Well, I think there's several things. First off, bureaucrats need to work with and for Vermonters and Vermont businesses instead of against them. And I hear from business many times that the people who come out for permits and inspections do seem to be working against them instead of for them. They are, if they're working for the state of Vermont, they're public servants and are supposed to be working for all of us. There are a lot of regulations and Act 250 in itself has a lot of positives, but also has some negatives. There was a affordable housing unit going in, a large one in Woodstock, that took over 9 years. Now, that shouldn't be allowed to happen. If you get into the Act 250 process, there should be a timeline. It's either a good project, and yes, we want it, or it's a bad project, and no, you don't. You should not keep developers tied up for 9 years waiting to get a project in. Another problem that I've heard a couple complaints on recently is that people within the Department of Environmental Conservation are redrawing wetland maps. One constituent had two lots, had his Act 250 permit, had the septic systems in, and they redrew the wetland lines because the beavers backed up a brook by his property. Now he can't sell two lots that he has a huge investment in. Once you have an Act 250 permit in place and you've already started spending money, you should be able to sell those lots.
And it comes down to Marcia.
Thank you. We've been having a problem here in Vermont with our workforce, population decline, and in terms of bringing in companies and adding to jobs, creating jobs. It's perhaps much more difficult now than it was in 2011, and there's a reason. We have not had a visionary direction from the governor, from his administration, from the Democrats and those few Republicans that have followed his lead. Legalizing recreational marijuana, that's not the environment that senior executives and Global Foundries or Intel, IBM would like to see their children raised in. Single-payer health care, a system funded, and I can't stress enough how irresponsible and corrupt and in fact just with blatant disregard the state of Vermont spent $300 million on socializing healthcare costs. They didn't have permission from the federal government, and they never even empowered themselves by way of amending their own constitution. Vermont Health Connect, there again, $200 million and we're spending on what should cost only one-tenth the amount. In order to attract jobs and industries such as, you know, the technology industry, we need to create an environment and have a vision that preserves Vermont, preserves what it is that we love about Vermont, how it is that we grew up. We're not interested in setting forth an environment that would lead to unknown consequences. That's not going to attract what it is that Todd here was referring to. Thank you. He's telling you to be quiet.
And not.
Moving right along.
Well, as I said earlier this evening, I was the owner of a business for about 30 years. And, you know, if you think back, the first 20 seemed to be pretty good. And then all of a sudden, it seemed like everybody got mean or nasty, unhelpful. You know, why aren't you doing this or why aren't you doing that? And this very day, and there's very few days that go by I don't get calls from somebody within our Senate district telling me how they've been abused by so-and-so from such-and-such a department and want to know who they should talk to get it straightened out and up above them. You know, bureaucrats, and I shouldn't say all, but a lot of them, do not have the knack and to want to work with people to say, well, you've made a mistake here and this is what you need to do to fix it. I'll be back in 2 weeks, a month, or 1 week. And maybe the third time or the second time back, it should get a little harder. But, you know, we've got all the attributes to make this a wonderful place for a business. Good schools, decent hospital, good environment. And how could you have anything any more beautiful than what we had in the last 3 weeks with our foliage season? So we've got the ingredients here to offer people. It's just to get them here, and then the regulators have got to be pleasant about their regulating. So, before I get done, I should say that that's one reason I'm supporting Phil Scott for governor, and I'm a Democrat, but I'm supporting Phil Scott because he's a business guy, he's an excellent person to work with, which I have done for 16 years, and I really think he would make a difference.
Next question starts with Marcia. What's that? Let's Grow Kids recently released a report showing that 93% of infants and toddlers in Orleans County do not have access to high-quality early care and education. What could you do to expand access to high-quality infant and toddler care in our community?
Are there not that statement doesn't refer to health care. That refers to child care and early development child care programs. Let's Grow Kids, they're advocates, and for very good reason, for funding, fully funding the STARS program. The STARS program needs another $9 million. The Shumlin administration, they had put in a request for $1 million. And the Shumlin administration didn't fund them initially, but after some hesitation, did so. Also, Head Start that would accompany the 8-week program from Act 122, that was meant to accompany an 8-week program, not be replaced by it. It needs to be funded fully year after year. We need to keep a level of continuity for our children, for early child development. We also need to set children as a priority here in the state of Vermont. Head Start, STARS, and any other program that allows parents to introduce their children to education with a level of quality and also allows parents to work. This is the backbone of our society, our children, the very early years, that parents continue to work, that children grow up in a household with parents working as opposed to parents having to be on welfare and having to leave the workforce. This is where it all begins. And it's a very systemic problem when parents have to sit at home and children cannot begin to, cannot attend early learning educational programs. Thank you.
And Bobby?
Yes. Children have always been very important to me. That's why I ran to be on the school board at a young age to make it better, start a kindergarten program in Troy, which we accomplished. The issue before us, it's hard to believe that 94% of our toddlers here in the kingdom need child care. But I think the word there is quality, because I know that there's quite a few mothers that don't work. And I should think that the best care in the world would be for that toddler to be with the mother. And so to get 94%, it's got to be some of these toddlers, even if their parents are home, aren't getting quality care, because that number shouldn't be that high. But what has transpired in the last 6 years, in my view, is that health care has dominated all of our money. It's been like a big vacuum on the money in Montpelier, and whether it's Health Connect or DCF, the money's been being pulled away for Medicaid and the Vermont Health Connect. That, of course, it's trash. But we've wasted a lot of money, so there hasn't been ample money to put into the STARS program, to put into early childhood, like Let's Grow Kids. Because I'll tell you, being a member of the Appropriations Committee, I sit there day in and day out and wonder, well, when is this bleeding going to stop with the health care so we can do things for people that really need some assistance? Because kids, it's all we're ever going to leave behind us is our children. And we better, those of us that are on Social Security, we probably will make it through. But the younger crew that's just behind us may not, if they don't have children that have jobs and pay wages into Social Security. So our kids are so important. We should be taking care of them.
And John?
Yeah, it is. It's tough. As Bobby said, there's so many competing interests, and I know Bobby and I have both tried to get increases in the child care subsidies. I remember when we had our second child, my wife quit work because she was paying the daycare pretty much everything she was making, and it wasn't taking into account the wear and tear on the car. And so we lived very frugally for quite a few years. And what would really be helpful is if we had a better economy and more good paying jobs, so that both parents didn't have to work, because I think the best thing for children is if one of their parents can be home with them, giving them that that good care and the best start that they can possibly get.
Next question starts with Bobby. And that question is, do you think Vermont's gun laws are fine as they are, or do you support expanding them, as in requiring universal background checks?
I think I don't own a gun. I never have owned a gun. I was home doing chores, and the rest of them all went hunting. So, I feel that our gun laws are adequate. I was reading about the registration of guns. Vermont has like 4,000 some odd guns, I guess it is, registered. But like Pennsylvania's got 290,000 guns registered. No, I really think that our gun laws are adequate. We have, very little violence with guns, and certainly our Constitution and the Second Amendment speaks to the gun issue, and I'm okay with it the way it is.
And to John.
Yes, I think all we need to do is enforce the laws that are currently on the book. What the proponents of a universal background check are not telling you is that there is no way to enforce a universal background check without complete gun registration. And I'm certainly not in favor of that. This Gun Sense Vermont that is pushing all these new changes is backed by billionaire Michael Bloomberg. It's out-of-state money and it's out-of-state values. Vermont is the safest state in the nation, even though we have an extremely high rate of gun ownership. And so I think if we enforce the laws that are on the book, we will continue to be the safest state in the nation. And Marcia.
2 years ago, a number of organizations, including myself, pointed to an absence of background checks at trade shows and the secondhand market. Now, as I understood it, there was a law was passed correcting that. Am I correct? Is that right?
Well, no.
We heard this from the
government. If you buy a gun on the internet, it has to be delivered to a gun shop that they run a background check on you before you can pick it up.
Most gun sales at gun shows go through background checks. Yeah.
Gun shows go through background checks. Now, what about the secondhand market now? Is it secondhand market checked at all then? I feel that there's probably some work we could do with this. Gun check, the mixed check is what's being referenced here. It's important. We had tremendous work 2 years ago, and in fact, the president had issued an executive order to states to make legislative changes. So I'm surprised in a way that there continues to be this issue. Those mental health issues, those with the problems of having been committed or having recently been released from a mental hospital, I understand those people are no longer eligible. We could certainly look at this some more, and universal background checks would certainly be the answer. Thank you.
And the next question we'll start with John. And we probably have time for one more question and then closing statements. So we will be wrapped up by 8 o'clock and we won't keep anybody up past their bedtimes. Or we can go home and watch Monday Night Football, one or the other. The final question, and the order will be John, Marcia, and then Bobby, and then closing statements. What is your position on a carbon tax?
I'm not in favor of a carbon tax. It would be a joke for Vermont to do it on their own. We would drive more businesses out of state. And the proponents of the carbon tax want to put the majority of that money towards more industrial renewables, which, back to the feeding the one percenters, it's the super wealthy that are making all the money off of this, and it would just be a disaster for Vermont's economy.
Marcia.
I'm firmly opposed to a carbon tax. It's inflationary. It removes money from the hands of the people, puts it into the hands of the state government. The state of Vermont doesn't need additional money. The state of Vermont needs to spend less, bottom line. No, a carbon tax would not be a good idea at this time for a number of reasons. We're, those who win this year's election are going to have to try to turn it around, or they're going to have to reverse a trend, cause a shift in consumer behavior. Those that we have elected now have caused this shift and are less likely to turn it around as far as I'm concerned. We're seeing their best, and the state is in decline. No, carbon tax isn't a good idea. Not at all.
And Bobby.
Yes. In Vermont, we put out 0.1% of the total carbon of all 50 states. 0.1%. And most of that comes from our cars and trucks, that where we're receiving services or we're driving our cars to work. So it's really an issue that's a non-issue that keeps cropping up, I think, to distract people from the real issues, which is the economy and jobs and the opiate addiction problem. We shouldn't be wasting our time dealing with this. Over in the Senate last year, when it was, this is another health issue, when word came over that they were thinking about or talking about doing a carbon tax, I think there was no support. There was no support. And the whole 30 members, there wasn't one person that was willing to push that. So I think it's a non-issue. If it ever became an issue, it would have to incorporate all the New England states plus New York and probably Quebec. Otherwise, it's a non-issue because you can't. It's a little bit like Health Connect. I mean, we tried doing that alone and you see how that turned out. Well, if we tried the carbon tax, it would be just as bad.
All right, and we'll do closing statements, and the order will be Marcia, Bobby, John. We'll just go right down the line. Each candidate has 3 minutes for their closing statements, and you can begin whenever you're ready.
Thank you. People, we have an important decision to make this election year. Phil Scott has explained that the current economic course of the state of Vermont isn't sustainable. If it continues with a tax receipt base in decline, a population in decline, we'll be in severe trouble economically. We have our senators and our currently elected legislators that have debated, that have worked very hard, that have toiled in committee, that know each other very well, that have been there for years, and have spent taxpayer money so carelessly. Some of them, many departments, in fact, are funded with dollars that are just in case. I, in fact, called one time, and he had $10 million just in case, in excess of what he needed. And he didn't have to tell anyone what it is that he spent it on. He intended to give a refund back to the state treasury, what he didn't spend, but nobody was really going to ask him what it was on. Not to mention repair and maintenance. There are excessive levels of funding for repair and maintenance of little office space, not the exterior of the building, folks. They're just renting offices inside a building, beautiful stone edifices in Montpelier. It's ludicrous, it's corrupt, it's criminal. And meanwhile, you know, the federal government does fund a considerable portion of our state budget, $5.6 billion for this coming year. I feel it's time that we move on. I feel it's time that, you know, Senator Starr and Senator Rogers could let me explain my perspective to the people without interrupting and making comments and stickers. I feel it's time that Vermonters look closely what it is that these our legislators have been doing. It's your money. It's your livelihood. It's your children's education. Instead of $300 million on single-payer health care, the sewer systems, an aging sewer line system here in Vermont could have been replaced and refurbished. Pipe can be filled with before they break with foam. It creates a PVC pipe inside. It's far less expensive than having to dig new lines. We have a high school system that is in need of additional funding for vocational schools. We can extend that considerably. We can build a better Vermont while preserving the Vermont that we have.